Hi everyone, greetings from NSN Hyderabad. If you've been following us on our YouTube channel, you must have watched several conversations with experts and heads of departments and heads of institutions connected with skill development, vocational training, vocational education, higher education, entrepreneurship, employability, and so on. And of course, CSR. And today we are taking forward our conversation on CSR with the head of skill development at Tata Steel. Let's welcome Captain Amitabh, who's the head of skill development at Tata Steel Jamshedpur, and learn from him about various initiatives that are being undertaken to help youth find gainful employment and continue with their education and training. So let's meet Captain Amitabh, who's with us today to share the story of Tata Steel, CSR-related skilling, and many other initiatives that they have been taking and leading in bringing lot of youth into the employment and giving them jobs and helping them become employable. So welcome to this talk, sir. Let's get started by asking you more about the initiatives at Tata Steel in skill development.
Thank you so much. And first of all, I'm really grateful that you have invited me, and I'm honored. So on behalf of Tata Steel Foundation, I would like to mention that CSR for us in Tata Steel is not a new thing, because Tata Steel is doing CSR for last more than 100 years. Now, coming to skill development per se, or like we were doing skill development in bits and pieces right from the beginning, maybe, you know, some training here and there. But for last 8-9 years, we have a structured approach towards skilling in CSR. So when we say skilling, so we have basically three models in Tata Steel Foundation. One is that we run institutes in partnership with reputed organizations. Second model is that we partner with good vocational training providers, and we have a tie-up and we provide them infrastructure support and other things. And third model is that we have partnered with some of the institutes wherein we identify young, bright students from marginalized section, and we sponsor them. So these are the three basic models. So now, having said that, so the first model, it is our technical training institutes. So which is in Jamshedpur, we are running Tata Steel Technical Institute. Then we, in partnership with Government of Jharkhand, we are running two ITIs, which is Tata Steel Skill Development Society, ITI Kamhat, and at which is in near Ranchi. And second is Jagannathpur, which is in West Singhu. So our skilling initiative, primarily we our target to marginalized section, especially from those, and since you know we are the operational areas in Jharkhand and Odisha, and therein majority of tribal population resides. So we target students who are coming from tribal area, tribal communities, and also from other marginalized section who otherwise would not have been able to get quality training. So our key emphasis when we provide skill training is not the numbers, but the quality of training and post-training employment. So that is, these are the two key areas which we look at. It's not that we could have gone for some training wherein we could have trained 10,000 people. But if the resultant is just 20% placement, then probably we would not go for that. So and I can tell you that the biggest measure that we have is placement. And till date, from our flagship programs, we have been able to achieve close to 100% placement.
Okay. Yeah, so you were just mentioning about partnerships. So could you tell us a little more about, maybe, you know, if people are interested to partner you, is there some criteria that you look for in such organizations and institutions?
Yeah, so we have various type of partner. The main partnership is implementing partner. So okay. Because as part of CSR, while we have our experience in CSR activities and also connect with the community, but we may or may not be having the expertise in running a particular institute. So say for technical institutes, we have a long-standing partner in NTTF, Netto Technical Training Foundation. Yeah. So we have been partnering with NTTF for last more than 12-13 years. Started even before our CSR activities. So the first thing that started was Adi Tata Technical Institute in Jamshedpur, which is a diploma college, which is wherein students from Jamshedpur and neighboring places they study. Then we partnered at Gopalpur, Jain Tata Technical Education Center. These two were non-CSR partnerships. But when CSR took into its fold to get into skill development seriously, then we started partnering with, we continued partnering with NTTF. So this is one partner. Then we have some good partners in who are well known. Like for hospitality sector, we have partnered with BLCC. For wellness and training, wellness, we have partnered with BLCC. For hospitality, we have partnered with Pratham. For apparel designing training, we have partnered with Shahi. So our key area where for the partnership is, one is quality, and two, their successful placement record. And three, since we are an organization which is known for its values, so our values should also be aligned when we look at a partner. So these are three main criteria. And of course, fourth is the need. If there is no need, then probably will not. So we do a proper due diligence in our area. In case, you know, there is a need and both demand, then probably both things are marrying up, then we find this partner and then we go ahead with the partnership.
Okay. So you were just mentioning about hospitality partner. It wasn't a bit clear. So could you repeat who's the hospitality partner?
So we have Pratham. Pratham as an organization, they are a hospitality firm. Okay. So they are doing, they call their program as PACE. So we have partnered with Pratham for this hospitality training, both at Jamshedpur and also at Gopalpur.
Okay, so besides this, I would also like to know a little more about your partnership with NTTF.
So as I was telling earlier, NTTF is our old partner. And yes. And in addition to being partnership, like we have shared very close relationship. And so we have, the best part about NTTF, what we have seen is they come with the new plans. Like generally what happens in technical training, because this is a dynamic world. And if you don't change the times, so the best part with NTTF that what we have seen is they are agile, and their academic council, every 6 months they meet, and in case there is a demand in industry or there are some feedbacks from the ex-students, they try and bring in those changes there. So that is where our partnership with NTTF is very good. And in terms of technical training, I would say NTTF is one of the very old institute known for the quality training, and therefore. And since both our value systems also is similar, because we want to do good for the community, Tata Steel is primarily, our major role is that how we can bring improvement in community, and especially youth who otherwise would not have been getting this such kind of education. And if I can tell you that in our institutes, we by design, we ensure that almost 50 or more than that percent of the students, they come from that sections. While we don't make it 100% thing, because we want more, the value, basically the merit, that should be the factor which leads you in rather than reservation. So that is where what we have done is, our model is, instead of diluting the standards for intake, what we do is we build the capacity of the students who are from their sections. So we do bridge programs. While we do not compromise in the intake, but we ensure that these people, these students who are coming from not so good background, they are trained, they are given this capacity building training, and there also NTTF helps us in organizing this bridge programs. And once that thing is done, then these people are onboarded in our schools.
I think that's a really great way to make them on par with the other category of students, like you mentioned about the bridge programs. A question related to the background of the students, it interests me to know more about is, how do you identify, mobilize such students and make sure that they stay on the job, when they are employed? Because we often hear that migration causes a lot of distress for such students because of their family backgrounds and others. So is there something you would want to tell us more about?
This is very important. I think it's really very important. Otherwise, if you train a person and then that person goes there and comes back, then we are not adding value to the society. So as I said, Tata Steel Foundation, we have an advantage here, because Tata Steel Foundation or Tata Steel CSR, we are an implementing CSR organization. Unlike other organizations, where you don't have that capacity. So our connect, we have a 700 good force in CSR department in Tata Steel. So our main emphasis in health, education, and livelihood. And skill development comes under livelihood. Yeah. So what we do is, since we have a very, very good grassroots connect with the community, so we understand what is their need. And since we have education programs also, so it's a very good link with education program to skills. So we identify these people who are interested in a particular field. We have a connection with them, not only with them, but with their family. with the PRI members of that particular village in case we are mobilizing from village. So we only would take people who are interested in that, who have the capability, who have the capacity. And we have also started about 2 years back one thing called in partnership with CII. It's called Model Career Center. So in Model Career Center, what we do is we identify these people and we do also a psychometric assessment of them. So which is the area that these people would be interested in, they are tend to do better. So we do all this analysis. Apart from that, we do counseling of students as well as their families. And once we get this, then we know, okay, these are the people who are suitable for one particular post, and then we put them on board. Because it's an effort. If we just get some students and fill in numbers, and if there are dropout rates, and if even if they complete this training, and then they go, don't join a particular job or something, then it's a loss for everyone.
Yeah.
So this is what we do. I think there is no, I would not say there is a magic wand or something or a formula per se. At different places, you have to deal differently. Like a tribal boy or a girl will have a different requirement. And maybe they would be very, very reserved initially. A boy or a girl from urban area would be having a different requirement. Coming from a particular background would have a different requirement. And since we have a support from our people, who are there on the ground, who are meeting their family day in and day out. So it becomes easier. It's not just one point touch that we mobilize people.
Yeah, I think this is absolutely essential for everybody to know that the process has to be rigorous as you just detailed it out. Otherwise, they may not stay on and it could lead to other issues. And as you very rightly said, it's not the number which matters, but the quality of people whom we are attracting and mobilizing. So along with this, another point is like now, let's say they have finished the training, they have completed the training and they are ready for placement. So are they absorbed in Tata Steel and Tata Group companies, or do they go to other companies as well?
So as I said, when we take these students, especially for our technical courses, Tata Steel is one of the options.
Yeah.
So we neither force them to join, nor they are only, it's the first right of refusal or something. We are very, very transparent there. If there is a requirement for Tata Steel, so they also come for our campus like any other company, and other companies also come for a campus. And depending on the need and depending on the interest of the student and the requirement of a company, people get selected. So in the past, we have got students who have been placed in Tata Steel. We have got students who have placed in Maruti. We have got students who have placed in Volvo's. We have got students placed in other Tata Group companies also part of Tata Steel. So it is not that we are training these people for our requirement only. We are training these skilled resources for the company. So that is what it is. And it's not only the technical training that I was earlier mentioning. So technical training, which is long-term course, which we are partnering with NPTF, would be a small percentage of the entire numbers that we train. Because it's a long-term training, 3 years, and the need of people is different, and the qualification also is different. So we have various programs for various category of students. Like for hospitality course, you don't need to be 10th pass also. So, but they get placed and they get placed in, say, 5-star property or something, and then they are able to get a good amount of money, which otherwise would not have been possible. So what we do is that we ensure that our placement, we don't compromise on that. We get so even in our hospitality programs, short-term programs, our placement has been more than 80%. So this is what it is.
Yeah. So along with this,
and just to add, maybe in 1 year. So apart from this. As I was telling, technical training, vocational training, and we also do capacity building program, which leads to self-employment or else, improvement in their employability chances. So close to 4,000 to 4,500 students are the ones we reach annually. For last 4-5 years, we have been doing that. And this year, last year was a big challenge, and therein the numbers got reduced. Only for our regular courses, wherein we are partnering with NPTF, we use this virtual medium to continue training, but it is a challenge for us to continue training in virtual.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, and when you mentioned self-employment, is it like a small micro entrepreneurship kind of a training that you give them? How do you prepare?
So as I said, especially when we are getting these students from villages and other places, what we have understood is not everyone would be interested in moving out.
Okay.
So we have to think of EDP, that is Entrepreneurship Development Program. And we have been doing entrepreneurship development program in addition to our this program, which are linked to maybe a migration, because not all the facilities are available in locally. So in our entrepreneurship development program, what we do is we identify the local needs, mm-hmm. and there we identify people who may or may not have passed out from our institute. Yeah. And then we have a system by which, like our partner earlier in Kalinganagar was BYSC, an organization called BYSC, Bharatiya Yuva Shakti Trust. And we have created close to 600 odd entrepreneurs. So which basically find job at that place itself. They could be in any field. And yeah. then we can possibly connect them to say Tata Steel vendor base or some other companies who are there. They can be doing training for them. Or else some small jobs. Like we have one program called Panchayat Bandhu. Panchayat Bandhu is basically what we do here is we identify a person maybe who is landless and he doesn't have much opportunity. But you know, for in village setup, for a small little requirement, you have to rush to urban area, say yeah. for a say two-wheeler repair or for a TV repair or a dish antenna repair. Every household, even in villages these days, would have a two-wheeler or a TV,
yeah.
right? So, but they have to go to urban areas. So what we do is, we identify only one person in the panchayat so that we don't create an internal competition itself.
Hmm.
So we identify one person, then we train them, and we also train them on skills as well as on entrepreneurship.
Okay.
Then that person goes back to that village and starts his or her business. So this yeah. is what is the model. So because aim is how post our intervention, people are gainfully employed. That could be self-employment, that could be wage.
Yeah, I think that's a wonderful idea to, help them remain in their own native places. And you were just mentioning about the current scenario, and my question to you would be on that. Right now, all the training programs are, being affected by COVID, and we have to make them blended, use various forms of online and e-learning formats. So with this as the backdrop, sir, what is your vision for skill development vocational training in future, let's say going ahead? How do you think such training can be made, very impactful and lead to gainful employment in the coming months or maybe a couple of years as well?
Yeah, first of all, I wish that this situation, we get over this as early as possible. Having said that, reality is that maybe we'll have to live with it for some time.
Yes, yes.
So maybe I think blended learning is the future, what I believe, because we have understood that there are so many things which you can do better virtually. So maybe, and then it also helps us in improving our scale. So people have devised ways, like even in technical training, we have found various simulators through which people can, even without coming to workshop, they can get an experience on working on a machine. Having said that, so what we can do is we could blend this thing wherein a part is virtual and part is you have to come for physical training for a particular thing. Having said that, we also need to ensure employers are ready.
Yeah.
So their sensitization is very, very important. While, because this we have experienced even because we want to promote girls in technical training. So while they are very well trained, in our ITIs, I can say that in our ITI Jagannathpur, it's not a girls ITI, but we have more than 30% girl candidates in an ITI. And all in like fitter, electrician, turner kind of a job. Mm-hmm. So this is what we found a great challenge. While we could train them and they are equally good or better than the male counterparts, but I think organizations still need to get to that. Okay, these people can also work on shop floor.
Right.
So that is where sensitization is also important in this regard. Also, those people who have been trained virtually, they are no less. They are equally good. So maybe employers also need to be sensitized. And I would like to add one more thing, which probably I missed. In last 3 years, what the one new initiative that we have started is training for persons with disability.
Mm-hmm.
So we call it a program initiative. Name is Sabal. So 3 weeks we do sensitization of employers. We train person with disability and we also do stakeholder engagement. So we have been able to place close to 50% with disability in various jobs. That is again, I think when we talk of diversity and inclusion, women and as well as person with disability, we need to improve.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And that's really interesting the way you highlighted the need for sensitization, I would say from the employer's perspective. For two things, one absorbing the girls who do very well in these technical training, and the second and most important is those who are coming from the blended learning format. I think this is still a very new thing for people to think that it gives you the same kind of quality, you know, as the face-to-face training. So maybe, you know, it may take a little bit of time. My last question to you would be, what would be your message to young people to improve their skills, particularly in the context, you know, where we still feel that getting a degree is the most important thing? We are not saying that we don't need a degree, but I think skilling is equally important. Yeah,
I think it's a very, very important question, and we have been really struggling. First thing, of course, I would come to young people, but before that, to society. I think in India, what is more important is dignity of labor.
Yeah.
You know, we associate a person with the kind of work he or she does, not that he or she is working. So that is very, very important. You know, if a plumber comes to your place, probably you would not offer him a sofa in your drawing room. Then in other places, if you go abroad, you know, people are respected by the work they do, the kind of skill set that they possess. So yes, that is very important. How we can, of course, it'll take some time, but slowly things are changing. And yeah, for young students, again, linked to this, no job is less. And like in a lighter vein, I always keep giving example of this Munnavaya MBBS wala movie, wherein Jadu Ki Jappi gives to the person who's, you know, mopping the floor. Yeah. And so because he was so diligent in his work, he didn't want anyone to, you know, disturb. And that is the quality that you bring in your work. So that is where I think my message or an advice or whatever you can tell for the younger generation is, don't be shy of doing a particular work, but ensure that whatever you do, it is of certain quality. It has a benchmark, national, international benchmark. Because students from ITI, I forgot to mention, we are getting students placed abroad also from our ITI. Whereas a normal ITI diploma holder in India demands a salary of about 12 to 13,000 initially, but there we have placed students in Hong Kong. For last 2 years, we have been placing, currently I think 12, 30 students are there. They demand a salary of around 1.25 lakhs in terms of Indian rupees per month. So that is the level. So the same skill which fetch you a particular amount, if you go abroad, it is getting more. And as our Prime Minister also says, now India can be a skill capital of the world. So we have the advantage of this demographic dividend. This is the time, I think, by all our younger generation, they should take advantage of the situation and skill themselves, do well.
Yeah, besides this, any other points you wish to share, which I might have forgotten to ask you?
Yeah, so a lot, basically, I think I always keep thinking in our skilling area, we should not restrict to some age-old skills. Like in ITI, when we talk of ITI, you know, still people, it is very, very difficult to mobilize students to trades other than fitter, electrician, turner. Mm-hmm. Because there are around more than 100 trades there, but people just flock for that. I'll give you an example. We started a training in mason in our ITI. Mm-hmm. It is very, very difficult to mobilize students in masonry because, one, it is not a fashionable job. Two, it requires certain hard work, because people will have to work in during day in the open. But having said that, the demand in masonry, the kind of infrastructure that is coming up, you don't get good masons. Because in India, what we get is the masons who have started as a labor and on the job they have learned. I'm not saying they're bad, but you know, whatever they learn, they inherit good or bad of the senior who is doing, but they are not technically qualified. So I think it is very, very important in India that we should have, like in NSCC, they have started with NSQF level courses. But for everything, I think, because there was a program by which they used to do recognition of prior learning.
Yeah.
So if we should make it mandatory, even a person, mandatory not in terms of that you won't be allowed to do, but maybe mandatory is not the right word. We should encourage people, they should have a bare minimum skill set when they go for a particular thing. So you know what, when you go to a barber, So all these simple skills, vocational skills, we don't respect them. You go to a plumber, they would not have done any formal course. They would not have done any formal training. While they are doing it, then whatever they have learned from their guru, even driving. If you see most of the, if there are statistics to prove in driving, especially in highway driving, more than 80% of the accident happen because of the mistake of the driver.
Mm.
Right? Because the drivers are not trained. They get trained, Khalasi and driver, guru the system is there. Wherein Khalasi is given steering on the empty road and he starts learning. So if we have a proper system, and we unfortunately we don't have this. And I got a chance to go to Dubai, and I saw that driving training school, which is very, very good. I think in India we need such kind of school, because it is not only skill, the quality of skills, but it is also leading to safety. So basically, I was saying, so skilling is important, but at the same time, it is not only for the wage employment or self-employment, but it is more also for the needs of the country, because how we reap the demographic dividend advantage, otherwise it becomes a demographic catastrophe. And two is how this is important even for the saving of lives. If a driver who is not trained well is on the road, he can harm people and himself or herself. Right. Similarly, in health sector, if you don't have the right kind of people who are there, if they don't do a good patient care, then it can lead to loss of life. So it is very, very important. It's not only just employment. It is much beyond that.
Yeah. Well, I think that was a very nice description about the risks that are involved if the skilling is not done for various job roles, along with the dignity of labor and many other aspects that you highlighted. So thanks a lot for sharing your views in such great detail and telling us the story of CSR from Tata Steel, which is so very dedicated to skilling and trying to imbibe all the principles of quality with a very value-laden system which you are trying to implement, I think, which others can also emulate. Thanks a lot, sir, for sharing your views today in this talk. I look forward to be in touch with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I look forward. Thank you so much.
So you were watching me speak to Captain Amita from Tata Steel, who was telling us in detail about the impact they are creating in the skills ecosystem by providing right skills to the youth to help them find employment or become job creators through self-employment. I hope you found this video very useful. I hope the conversation helped you learn and also explore ways of contributing to the evolving skilling ecosystem in India. In case you wish to watch such conversations and get more and more updates, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. This is a request from all of us, the team NSN. And don't forget to hit the bell icon. This will help you in getting all the notifications as soon as we publish a video so that you don't miss anything from us. Thanks a lot. Goodbye. I wish to be in touch with you. Thanks again.